morning. Thanks be to God for another glorious day. We'd like to welcome you to Kingdom Praise Ministries. We thank God for you being with us once again this week. We are growing in our followers. We thank God for the followers that we have. We're growing in response. Our response is up. Thank God for you listening. And I pray, God, most of all, that someone's growing closer to the Lord as a result of this ministry. So our purpose is to lift up the name of Jesus and to reach people for Christ, to encourage the saints of God. So we come today to give God praise for all that he has done. And I will lift up a word of prayer for us today. My daughter, our minister in training will come. Vashti will come, we're in selection, and then we'll get into the word of God. Father, I thank you right now for your blessings and for your mercies and for your compassion and for your love and for allowing us to see another day. We're grateful, God. We don't take this for granted, nor do we take it lightly that you've allowed us to see another day. You've kept us in the midst of a world that's that seems unkept, a world that seems like things are going crazy everywhere, but you have decided to preserve us, to keep us, to watch over us. And for this, we say thank you.
Thank you
for another day. And we don't forget those families that are suffering financially, those families that are suffering physically, those individuals that are suffering with this COVID-19. There's many people that are sick and ill and in the hospitals. We don't forget them today, but we lift them before you, God, and ask for your mercy, asking for your healing, asking for your deliverance in their lives. And we thank you even now. And we pray for those who have lost loved ones. All of us have been touched in some way by this disease. We pray for those who lost loved ones, oh God, that you will lift up those heavy hearts, oh God. We pray, oh God, you will be a source of strength and encouragement during these dark days. We know the darkness is there, but the light always outshines the darkness. And we just come right now, God, to give you praise, honor, and glory. So be a source of strength and comfort to those under the sound of my voice. And we pray, God, today that a song will be sung, a word spoken, a prayer offered that will lift someone's heart. We thank you for your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
You don't have to worry, and don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. For there's a friend named Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it.
Yes, Lord.
I know that I can stand, no matter what may come my way. My life is in your hands. You don't have to worry, and don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. For there's a friend named Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand, no matter what may come my way. My life is in your hands. With Jesus I can take it. With him I know I can stand, no matter what may come my way. My life is in your hands. So when your tests and trials, they seem to get you down, and all your friends and loved ones are nowhere to be found, remember there's a friend named Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. Yes. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. With Jesus, I can take it. With him, I know I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. With Jesus, I can take it. With him, I know I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. My life is in your hands. My life is in your hands.
Amen.
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 Woo! Thank God we know our life is in his hands. Amen.
Amen.
God is an awesome God. This morning I'd like to call your attention to a passage of scripture. It's pretty familiar. John 1. Verse 14, the Gospel of John, first chapter, 14th verse. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, I thank you right now. I pray, oh God, the things that you placed upon my heart to share, that you would help me to clearly articulate them to your people today.
Amen.
I give you praise. I need your spirit. I can't do anything without you. So Spirit of Living God, please fall fresh on this, your manservant today. And may the words I speak be acceptable in thy sight and controlled by your spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Just for a few moments, I would like to lift for the subject, the tent. The tent. All right. When I look at this first chapter of John as a student of the Word of God for many years, as a preacher and a teacher, I am humbled by the truths that this contains. And when I ask God, well, what bearing does this great truth have on our everyday life? He begins to show me that it has everything to do with our everyday life. Because the reason why we're experiencing so much chaos today is because there is a neglect of God's word. Mm-hmm. There's an absence of God's presence. The world has asked God to get out. Some are saying that he does not exist. Some are saying that we were here by evolutionary processes. Some are saying that we're here by some, I know that there's an intelligent designer, but I don't know who he is or what it is, or even if it is a person. People are saying all kinds of things, and because we have no real light in our lives, that means we have no direction. We're living in a dark world, and I would dare to say we need some light. Mm-hmm. We need some light in our school systems. We need some light in our in the White House. We need some light on our streets. We need some light in our houses. We even need some light in our churches. Mm-hmm. We need light, and Jesus is the source of that light. He is the one that says that if you follow me, you will not walk in darkness, but you will have the light of life. He is the originator of all things. When I think about Old Testament, for instance, I think about what goes to my mind in Moses. He was instructed to build this tent out in the wilderness. And in this tent, he had built various items in that tent. There was the altar of incense. There was the table of showbread. There was the candlesticks. There were these various things that God instructed Moses to build and to make and overlay them with gold. And Moses would go out. Most of all, there was this curtain that's behind this curtain. It's called the Holy of Holies. There was the Ark of God's Covenant, which had the Ten Commandments on stone. It had a portion of manna that was there. It also had a lid called the Mercy Seat. It had two angels that overshadowed the Mercy Seat with their wings facing toward each other. And between those wings, God would meet with Moses. Between those wings, God would commune with Moses. Between those wings, Moses would get instruction. And above that tent, when God was not speaking directly to Moses, God was leading his children by fire in the night and a cloud in the day. And this represented his presence to Israel. It's called the Shekinah glory. And when Moses would go into that tent, you know what God would do? God would come down, his presence would come down and meet Moses in that tent. Called the glory, the Shekinah glory of God. And we come to the New Testament. We see in this particular passage of scripture, we see there's a person that's called the Word of God. The Word of God, the beginning of John says that in the beginning was the Word. It goes back to Genesis. He says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The glory of this passage is that before anything was made, there's this Word was. In the beginning was. That was is an eternal was. Before anything was, Jesus was. Amen. Which means that he is outside of time. He is pre-existent. He is before all things. And when I think about this, I also think about what Paul said in the 11th chapter of 2 Corinthians. He talked about false teachers coming in and teaching about another Jesus. Did y'all know it was another Jesus? Another Jesus? Another gospel. He talked about false apostles. There's another Jesus. You know who the other Jesus is? The other Jesus is the one that man defines as Jesus. Mm-hmm. And we have to be careful in our faith to make sure we have the right Jesus. Mm-hmm. The reason why I'm going through all this to say this is that if you miss who Jesus is, you miss salvation.
Miss everything.
If you miss who Jesus is, you're going to hell. If you miss who Jesus is, there is no life or light. So you got to make sure. Take a neighbor. Make sure you got the right Jesus.
You got the right Jesus.
So in this gospel, the gospel of John, the fourth gospel, there's three other gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are called the synoptic gospels because they're similar in their material. But John's gospel stands out because John, when he talked about Jesus, he didn't deal with the manger. He didn't deal with Gabriel, the angels. He didn't deal with Joseph and Mary. He didn't deal with the wise men or the star. He jumped right in and began to describe to us who Jesus was. Amen. And he says that he is the Word of God. He is the very Word of God. If you go to the book of Genesis, you'll see that when God made something, he said it. So Jesus is that creative Word of God. Not only was Jesus in the beginning, the Bible says this, that not only was he in the beginning, in the beginning was the word was with God. Has an idea of someone on God's level. Wow. Someone who could see and talk to God face to face. That word with has pros, means face to face. Someone who could communicate with God. He's pre-existent, but he also has a relationship going on with God. before the world was. He has a coexistence with God. Amen.
Amen.
He has a coexistence. The Word was with God, and the Bible says this, and the Word was God, John 1:1. The Word was God. So we understand that we got to make sure we got the right Jesus. Because a whole lot of people do not want to accept the deity of Christ. You've got the Muslims who say that he is a good prophet. You have the Jehovah's Witnesses who says that he is an angel. All right? You have various groups saying that the Jews have not accepted them as their Messiah. So you got a whole lot of people saying a whole lot of different things about Christ because the devil attacks this more than anything. We got to get this thing right. Because what we say about Jesus determines where we'll spend eternity. What we say about Jesus determines how we'll live our lives. What we say about him determines where we will live our lives forever, whether it be in hell or in heaven. So I think that's important, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So John takes the time to dig beneath the surface things of the manger and Mary. He jumps right in and says, this is the word. And the verse that I've given before is the 14th verse of this chapter. The word was made flesh. That's how John summed up all of what Luke said about Mary and Joseph and the angel. John just says, the word was made flesh. The word was made flesh. This word that was co-equal and co-eternal and co-existent with God now has become man. Not half man and half God, but fully man and fully God. And I'm so glad today just to know him. How about you?
Amen.
I'm so glad today not just to know facts about him, but to know him for myself.
Personally.
And that is very important, that we not just study the Bible for facts, but we study the Bible for relationship.
Mm-hmm.
We can study about people of the past, but never have a relationship with them. I can read about Martin Luther King. I can read about all the greats of the past, but I've never knew them or had a relationship with them. So their lives may inspire me, but their lives won't transform me.
Mm-hmm.
But here is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. God, the second person of the Godhead, the eternal one. Now he comes into flesh. He's manifest in the flesh, fully man and fully God, without diminishing either one. It's a great mystery of the Christian faith, but yet it's true. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He lived among us. This word, dwelt among us, is the same word I talked about for my subject today, the tent. This is the word that means that what God did was God put up a tent. Amen. And within that tent, he would meet with man. Within that tent, God will be brought to one in relationship with man. He says, we beheld that God has dwelt among us. God is the one, when Moses went into that tabernacle and he met with God, we had the same opportunity to go into the tent and meet with God. You know what happened to Moses while he was there? The Bible talks about Moses met with God. This was when he went to the mountain to get the Ten Commandments, that Moses' face shone. And it shone so bright that the people didn't want Moses had to cover his face. It frightened the people. When we go into God's presence, we ought not come out the same. When we spend time with God, our lives ought to be changed. When we spend time with God, God not only tells us to love him, he tells us to love each other. And boy, what a different world it would be. What a different situation it would be. Because if we got hold to the love of God, it wouldn't be any prejudice out here.
Amen.
We got hold to the love of God, wouldn't be any fights in the streets. We got hold to the love of God, wouldn't be any protesting. Because the love of God tells us that all men are created in God's image. Amen.
Amen.
No matter what the color of your skin is. See, our problem is not a skin problem. Our problem is a sin problem.
Mm-hmm.
Our problem is an arrogance. Do you know that we are so arrogant in the United States? Do you know that we're suffering in this pandemic because we are so arrogant? We are so arrogant, we won't do what the science tells us to do. We're so arrogant, we think that it is an insult to my liberty to put a mask on my face.
Mm-hmm.
We are so arrogant, we won't listen to scientists, so I know we're not going to listen to God.
Mm-hmm.
We're so arrogant, this is why we're suffering so. God is letting us know this world world is not ours. God is letting us know that every right we have, he has endowed us with. God is letting us know that he is in control. This is God's world.
Yes.
This is God's business. God is in control. He letting us know all he got to do. You want him to really get out? All he got to do is lift his hand. Mm-hmm. All he got to do is lower the hedge of protection. All he's got to do is let one germ get out. And he can bring down a great economy. Mm-hmm. One germ get out. One disease get out. He can bring everything to his knees and to a halt. The God that we serve may not have caused this, but he allowed it to happen. Mm-hmm. He allowed it to happen to let us know that we are not in control. Mm-hmm. He wants man to know that we've got to come to a place where we're meeting with God. We got to come to a place where we go into the glory. Aren't you glad that God still has a tent of meeting?
Yes.
And his name is Jesus.
Yes.
And aren't you glad that we know what God did? God set the tent of meeting out in the wilderness. Oh, glory to God. He set it out there in the wilderness. You know what? He was letting them know no matter how dark it is, you can still have God's presence.
Yes.
No matter how much lack there is, you can still walk with God. You know what God did for the Israelites? He took them to the wilderness experience, but he provided for them.
Yes,
I don't know what you're going through right now, but I want you to know there's still a tent in the wilderness.
Yes.
I don't know what you face, but I want you to know there's still hope in a hopeless situation.
Yes.
God provided for them. But where are all these people, millions of people, where are they going to eat? God brought bread. He rained down bread from heaven called manna. What are we going to eat? God caused quails to come in the wilderness where they're not supposed to be. He fed his people. What are we going to drink? God told Moses to speak to the rock. Mm-hmm. And the water came out of a rock.
Yes.
Who's going to provide for us? God wanted them to know that you don't need anybody but me.
Amen.
God didn't let their shoes wear out. God didn't let their feet swell. God kept them well all the years they were there because God wanted them to know that he was in control.
Yes.
And I'm here to tell you today, it doesn't matter what's going on around us. It doesn't matter how dark it gets on this side. I'm so glad I know that we got a tent.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
His name is Jesus. He pitched his tent among us. And aren't you glad that he came to do what he did?
Yes.
He came to show man what a real man could be.
Mm-hmm.
He came to live under the unction of God's spirit. He walked. And he showed forth his glory. We beheld, John says, as gospel writer says, and we beheld his glory. John knew that when he walked with Jesus, can you imagine? He walked with Jesus and saw him on the Mount of Transfiguration. He saw him change the water into wine. He saw him heal the blind. He saw him do his mighty works. But John says, we've seen his glory. But I want you to know that we can also put ourselves there. I know I got a witness somewhere.
Yes.
And you've seen his glory.
Mm-hmm.
How many have seen his glory?
Yes.
You've seen his glory by his keeping power.
Yes,
you've seen his glory by his healing power.
Mm-hmm.
You've seen his glory by his provision power.
Yeah.
God
yes.
is still showing his glory.
Yes.
We have seen his glory. We might have saw like John did. John was able to touch him and handle him, he said. John was able to walk beside him. But I want you to know, you can still see it today. You can see his glory by faith. But what did Moses meet in that tent? Moses met the glory of God. And now the glory of God is now set in this tent in Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ now lives in you. Aren't you glad about it?
Amen.
You got a meeting place. And I think about all that God did for us and all he said to us in our lives. And you can sum it up in this, that God wants to meet with man.
Yeah.
What a God we serve.
Yeah.
Why would God want to meet with man? Why would God want to give man of his instruction? Because God wants man to have life and he wants to have it more abundantly. God wants man to walk in the light that he's given. God wants man to live as God dictates. But you know what? This word of God that we talk about today, the word was made flesh, this word of God not only wants to be a person that we know about, he wants to be a person that can have meaning and impression on our lives. He now wants to tell us how he wants us to walk. This is not our world. You see what man does when he gets in charge.
Mm-hmm.
He brutalizes people.
Mm-hmm.
He takes advantage of people.
Mm-hmm.
He robs the poor and gives to the rich. When man's in control, he mistreats the marginalized. When man is in control, the world goes crazy. But God is saying that if you let me rule, I will rule through your life. We pray it all the time. And in the Lord's Prayer, we call it, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We haven't seen that yet. But God wants to do that by ruling through his individual people. We want the world to understand that although it's dark, God still has a light.
Yes.
Aren't you glad about that today? He says that in this tent, he says, we've seen, we beheld his glory. Have have you beheld his glory? You know what the word behold means? It means you got to stay and look a while. Hallelujah. You got to sit back and look a while. When you're going through trouble and trying time, you got to learn how to sit back and behold the glory of God. You got to realize that the same God who made you, made the world, is holding it all together. He can hold the world together. He can hold the atoms together. He can hold things together. He can sure enough hold my life together.
Yes.
If God could take the world and put it on the axis, if God could put the world up there out with nothing supporting it, and cause it to turn around and spin without anybody flying off of it, surely God can take care of me.
Yes.
How many know he take care of you? His eye is on the sparrow. Yes. And I know he watches me. Y'all know God looks out for the birds?
Yes.
God's going to look out for you. God looks out for the grass? He's going to look out for you. You better touch yourself and say, God's going to watch over me.
God's going to watch over
God's me. God's got me. How many know God's got you?
Yes.
God has got you. He says, we beheld his glory. Take time out to behold his glory. Take time out to remember who God is. John says, we see it, and we can also put ourselves there and say, we have seen the glory of the only begotten Son. This word begotten doesn't mean a beginning. This word begotten has the idea of a uniqueness. There's one of a kind. One of a kind species. In other words, we say it like this, there's nothing like it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There's none beside him, none to compare to him. He is the only begotten or the uniquely begotten Son of God. Because there's no other person on this earth that is fully God and fully man. No other one can do what he can do. You and I have God's spirit in us, but we're not fully God. Matter of fact, we too much man, aren't we? Man side of us gets all in the way. But thanks be to God, we have one on the earth. He's the only begotten Son. He is the beloved Son of the Father. The Bible says he's this. He came to the earth manifest, but he's full of grace and truth. Aren't you glad about that today?
Amen.
He could have come down and be full of judgment. He could have been down and be full of vengeance. But thank God that he's full of grace and truth. What does full mean? That means that he's controlled by it. Mm-hmm. When someone's full of anger, they're controlled by anger. When someone's full of joy, they're joyful. When someone's full of peace, they're peaceful. So when you're full of the Spirit controls your life. So he's full of grace and truth. That means that he got plenty of it. Aren't you glad about it? Because let me tell you, if it was just truth, we'd all be dead. I mean, truth is reality. Truth peels off the facade. Truth is that when you look in the mirror and see it like it is. Truth is reality. Not reality according to how I see it, but reality how God sees it. We got to get a view of how God sees it. And God sees us just like we are. But aren't you glad that God's got grace and mercy?
Yeah.
Matter of fact, you put grace first. Amen?
Yeah.
Because grace is God's unmerited favor. Grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. It's grace, God being good to us in spite of us. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
God being good to me in spite of what I've done.
Yes.
Grace holds back the what I really deserve and gives me what I don't deserve.
Yes.
Grace is God's love and God's concern for us. Thank God for grace and mercy. You know what a perfect picture of grace and mercy is? It's the cross. Because the same Jesus that came down through 42 generations. The same Jesus who is the Word, who was with God and is God. The same Jesus, born of the Virgin Mary. The same Jesus went to the cross, and there you meet grace and mercy. You see grace and mercy, no, grace and truth. There you see grace and truth. You see what it is? The truth is that I deserve to die. The truth is that I don't deserve to go to heaven. The truth is I don't deserve anything. That's the truth. But grace says I'll pay the price. Aren't you glad about it?
Amen.
Grace says I'll take care of the charge. Grace says I'll take care of it. So grace and mercy join together on the cross. Aren't you glad for grace and mercy?
Yes.
How many are glad the Bible says we're saved by grace?
Yes.
You know that? So I don't care what high horse you want. Come off that high horse. Because the only reason why we're saved is by grace and mercy. That's no difference from me than anybody in the street except for God's grace. Aren't you glad that God's grace caught you right in time?
Yes. Yes.
Aren't you glad that you can still meet with God?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that God set a tent up for you?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that whatever you need, he's there for you?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that God will make a way for you out of nowhere? I know I got a witness somewhere.
Yes.
God will see you through. Aren't you glad that God has a plan? His plan includes you. His plan is a plan. He says he's going to work it out for your good. Are you glad about that?
Yes.
No matter what you're going through, you better tell yourself, this is going to work out.
Yes.
Hallelujah. This is going to work out. Even Joseph, after he'd been sold out by his brothers. Joseph was sold out by his brothers and sent to Egypt as a servant. You know what happened? He went from the prison to the palace. And you know what he said to his brothers? His brothers were afraid when they saw Joseph. They thought Joseph would take out vengeance. And Joseph said, don't be afraid. He said, you meant it for evil. but God meant it for good. Amen. That means that God can take the stuff that looks like it's evil. God can take those backbiting friends. God can take those people that sold you out. And God can say, when they intended for you to your evil, God says, I have an intention. I mean it for your good. Aren't you glad about that?
Yes.
Joseph didn't know God had a great plan for his life. And I want you to know that although you're going through dark days, God's got a great plan for your life.
Yes.
All you got to do is trust him. Amen?
Amen.
Trust him and believe he's going to work it out. I don't care what you're going through. Through sickness, God is good. Through health, God is good. When I have it, God is good. When I don't have it, God is good. The God you serve is able to touch, heal, and deliver right where you are right now. Because Jesus Christ was made manifest in the flesh. The word was made flesh. Aren't you glad about it? And tabernacled with us. Set up a tent with us. And we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten Son of God. Full of grace and full of truth. This is the God that we serve. He's a mighty God.
Yeah.
And I want to let somebody know who's listening to me today that me, I can't make it without him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Me, when I realized that God went through all he went through just to meet me, just to worship, for me to meet him in an intimate way, and I think about how the hours I waste and not give him the time of day, it makes me feel bad. You know why? Because I realize that all the problems I sit back and worry about, all I got to do is let the light shine on them. The situation I try to struggle with, all I got to do is let the light shine on them. The things I worry about, all I got to do is let the light shine on them. Say, Jesus, I'm here to be with you. Show me what to do. And if we trust him, the Bible says this, he will give us wisdom. He will give us wisdom beyond what we could ever imagine. So trust God with your life. Trust God with direction. Trust God for his power. Trust God when you can't see your way. Trust God even when you're hurting. Trust God when you don't know what to do. Because God, the God we serve, was in the beginning. Amen.
Amen.
He put it all together.
Yes.
And guess what? He's still in control.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The earth is the Lord's. The fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. I'm so glad to know Jesus today.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I'm so glad to know that Jesus Christ is a word that was made flesh, became flesh. And not only does he understand, see God, God as Father knows everything, but God the Son feels everything.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God the Father, he knows everything there is to know. But God the Son actually became one of us. So now he can feel my hurts.
Yes.
He can feel my pain. We found out, I preached last week, he'll cry with us.
Yes.
When we go through. Aren't you glad about that?
Yes.
I'm here to tell you, you got a friend. Some of y'all, I walked around looking for a best friend. When I was a youngster, never could find one. As soon as I thought I had one, they let me down. Man will always let you down. But now I found that there's one best friend.
Mm-hmm.
His name is Jesus. Let me leave you with this story. This little girl and her mother, little girl comes in the house and her face is dirty. And the mother sees the little girl. And the mother doesn't shy the little girl. No, the mother's the, what was the mother's instinct? Y'all mothers know. First thing you're going to do is get your rag out.
Mm-hmm.
What? And start cleaning that child out. But while you're cleaning them, see, that's grace. While you're cleaning them, you're also going to find out why you're cleaning them. You're going to find out, well, how did you get this dirty?
Mm-hmm.
What did you do? That's the truth. Aren't you glad? Not only does God see your dirt, he'll clean you up.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll deal with the dirt.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Aren't you glad about the day?
Yes.
He loves us that much. He's a father. I don't think we realize that. He is a father. As a father pities his son, so the Lord pities his children. He is a father. And a father's love outweighs our sin and outweighs our downfalling. A father's love is there waiting for us just to come back. He wants to clean us up.
Yes.
But while he's cleaning us, while he's wiping off the dirt, the result of our sin, he's also asking, how did you get here? What's going on with your life? So God not only wants to love on you, he wants to clean you up.
Yeah.
Amen.
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 Let him do it. That's the Jesus we know. He doesn't discharge you. He doesn't condemn you. He didn't come to the world to condemn you. He came to the world that you might be saved.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is there anybody out there that wants to know him? You can come to know him today simply by believing. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If you believe on Jesus Christ, you can have salvation. Yes. Trust him as your Savior. Take him as your Lord. If you've done that, pray that prayer, ask God to come into your life. Now trust him to guide your life. And find out what he wants you to do, what he wants to do through your life. That's all important. Not only take him as your Savior, but accept him as your Lord. Yes. I no longer call my own shots. I no longer live for me, but now live for his glory. Amen. Yes.
Amen.
You want to live for his glory now. The one that died for you. There's a story, I'm going to finish with this story. There's a story of, based on a true story, I'm not going to get all the facts right, but I'm trying to get it. There was a story where out in the jungle, there was a missionary, and he saw a young boy who was being attacked by a lion. The lion was about to destroy that young child. The missionary went over and killed the lion and rescued the boy. Went about his way. Did what he thought was necessary for any of us to do. We could save somebody, we try to save a life. Went home. The next day, the boy came with a whole bunch of people behind him. Had all his belongings. And a missionary went out to say, what is going on? What is all this? He says, I'm coming to live with you. He said, why are you coming to live with me? He says, because the one who saved me, my life, our custom is the one who saves me, my life now belongs to him. Because I'm only here because you saved my life. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Wow. Amen.
Amen. Y'all see the picture? Mm-hmm. Can y'all realize that? Mm-hmm. The one who saved me, I now owe my life to. You better pack your bags up and go out to the tent. Amen.
Amen.
And meet God for yourself. Because the only reason why I'm here today is because he saved me. Amen. That one who saved me, I now give my life to as his servant. Amen.
Amen.
That's the title. You want to know what my title is? My title is servant. You're not going to take any title to come with you. When you die, you're going to leave all your PhDs, your MDs, all the other Ds. You're gonna leave all those titles behind, and you, because you want to hear the Savior say, "Well done,
amen,
my good and faithful servant." That's the title you're going home with. Amen.
Amen.
So above all things, he says, "Be servant." If you want to be great in God's kingdom, be a servant of all.
Yeah.
Let's get busy serving each other. Be a blessing to somebody. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, I thank you today for your word is light. Your word is life. Your word is powerful. We found out today that your word is a person. The person of Jesus Christ. Your spoken word. Your living word. Your powerful word. The word that always was and always will be. Your eternal word. And although, Father, I tried to spell it out as clearly as I could, I feel so inadequate to handle things like talking about who God is. But please, God, with these feeble words and efforts of mine, please, God, touch somebody's heart, touch somebody's life, yes, to give them a new appreciation that you got a tender meeting. Mm. We're here now, God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. In your presence, oh God.
Yes, Lord.
Only you can fix us. Only you can fix this situation. Only you can fix this world. Only you can fix our lives. Only you can fix our loved ones. Only you can heal our bodies. Only you can protect us. We're here, God, in our tent of meeting today.
Yes.
Meeting with you in your presence because of what Jesus Christ did. Because he became flesh and dwelt among us. We're here meeting with you, calling on your name for this country. Calling on your name, Father, for the leadership that is here. Calling on your name, God, for the disease that's running rampant. To ask you to have mercy, oh God. Calling your name, God, for salvation. Calling on your name, oh God, that you would send laborers into the vineyard. To tell somebody that Jesus lives. For you said that latter days would be worse and worse. We're living in those latter days. But you said that your light shines in darkness. And the darkness will not overcome it. The darkness can't understand it. It won't overcome it. So we come today, God, to thank you for the light. The light of life. Guide our footsteps. Not according to your will, to our will, but according to your will. Guide our footsteps. Not what we want, but what you want. Hallelujah. Your will be done in and through our lives. For this we just say thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Guide our day according to thy will. Let someone under the sound of my voice come into a relationship with you. We got to go beyond, Lord, giving you a nod and a handshake, to opening our hearts to let you come in and change our lives. Hallelujah. We thank you right now, God. And we call upon your name for salvation. Save somebody. Heal somebody. Deliver somebody. We ask in the name of Jesus, and we count it done. In Jesus' name, and by his authority, be healed, be delivered, be free, be whole. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. God bless Amen. You. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. And I pray that somehow I'm trusting that God has touched someone's life through this message and through this ministry and through these songs today. So go out. Don't just get a blessing. Go out and be a blessing. Yeah. God bless you. We'll see you next time.
Amen. Mm-hmm.